Hello and welcome to Norwegian Woods. In this video I'm going to spend the night here in this old spruce forest. I have actually been in this area quite a few times before, but I've never spent the night in this place. So I'm looking forward to that. And as you can see, I brought with me two backpacks for this trip. One of the packs is filled with my camping gear, and the other backpack is filled with more backpacks. My plan is to talk a little bit about my different backpacks, my pouches and my bags and all that kind of stuff that I use for my small trips out in the woods. I think it's an important topic and I want to give my thoughts on it. As usual, it's getting a little bit late and it's soon going to be dark, and I want to put up my hammock before the night comes, because I want to just chill out and enjoy this little piece of spruce forest. And there's actually a game trail right next to my camp spot, so maybe I will be able to see some wildlife during the evening or in the morning. You never know, most likely I will just scare all the animals away, but there's a small chance. Thank you. then I've had a really good night's sleep. I didn't see any animals walking by on this trail next to my camp spot during the night. If they did, they were really silent and didn't wake me up. But it was actually an animal that woke me up. It was this little squirrel that was jumping around in the trees above my hammock. And there was this little twigs that fell down on me. So yeah, that woke me up. I guess this little squirrel was complaining about my the spot I picked. I can see that there's some leftover from some pine cones around next to the trees. So I guess he liked to sit up there and eat pine cones. We have quite a few of these red squirrels here in Norway. They are really fascinating animals, just to sit and watch when they climb around in the trees and jump from tree to tree. They're some real athletes. Another bird that I really associate with the springtime and the early summer is another of these birds I don't know the English name for. It's called rugde in Norwegian. It's it's brown, pretty small bird with long legs and a long beak, so it's kind of a water bird. And in the evenings, in the springtime, they fly around right above the treetops and makes this really nice and easily recognizable sound. And I heard it yesterday. It's the first time this year I've heard rugdetrekk. And that's also another really awesome sign of that the spring is coming. I see that there's one little mosquito is flying and searching for some food. So I guess this is the last camp for this part of the season, for my part, without a bug net. I guess with another week with this nice and warm weather, we will get a lot of these little bugs, I guess ticks, and also this black flies, these midges, I think they're called. They will soon be out, and then I need to bring some bug spray and use the bug net. But yeah, that's part of the summer. As I mentioned, I want to talk a little bit about my bags and backpacks and all the little pouches I use, because yeah, you see, I have this little idea that I want my videos to have some kind of topic, some kind of subject that I go into, and I have long list of different topics I want to make videos about, and some of these topics is also about gear related stuff. So yeah, and this video I have been I wanted to do it a little while ago, but there was one of my backpacks that I wanted to swap out, because it didn't actually fit my needs the way I wanted. And now, just a few weeks ago, I managed to sell off my old backpack and buy the one I really wanted. So I guess I'm pretty sorted out, and I think I have a setup and a selection that suits my needs. When I go out in the woods, I think it's quite important for me to have a good way to carry all the stuff that I need for that that trip in a comfortable and organized way, so I so it doesn't hurt me when I walk out, and I can easily find all the little bits and bobs that I bring for my trips. Over the years, I have acquired quite a lot of different gear like this, and all the stuff that I will talk about in this video is things that I have bought and paid for myself. I also see that a few people like to make the backpacks and pouches themselves. There's a lot of ways you can do it. You can use modern materials, or you can go all out kind of bushcraft and make it out of the stuff you find out in the woods. You can make some frames you can use as a backpack, or you can weave baskets, and I will probably look more into that side of carrying stuff in the future, because I think it's a really fascinating topic. Beside these backpacks, I also have quite a lot of different pouches and small bags that I use to organize my stuff inside my pack. And it's convenient for a few different reasons. Mostly it's easier for me to find the little pieces I bring out. And it's also a good way to keep some stuff clean and dry when I'm out in the woods. And when I'm at home, it's nice to keep some of the stuff together as a kit. That sometimes you have a lot of small things that make up one purpose or one piece of gear, and then it's nice to keep it in a pouch, so it's it's convenient when I pack up my stuff before I go out, so I don't forget anything that I need that for that piece of kit to work. This here is my main pack, you could say, the one I can use for most of my trips all year round. It's called Bergans Trollhetta 95 liter, and it's at the maximum it's a 95 liter backpack, and it's got this internal soft frame. It's not the frame on the outside as a couple of my other packs have, so it's kind of flexible, so it moves together with your body. This kind of design is called an anatomical backpack, and there is some adjustment, so you can adjust the distance from the hip pack or hip belt up to the shoulder straps, so you can you can adjust it to quite a few different body lengths. The pack itself have a lot of pockets. You have one on each side here on the hip belt. I like to have a pair of gloves in one of them. Always always handy to have. The other one I can try to show you. You can pop out the bottom and it fits a 1 liter drinking bottle, and you can actually zip it together on top of it, so we have some water on the hip belt. That's kind of convenient. It has a lid with three pockets, one main one at the top with zippers on the back here, so you can fit quite a lot of stuff inside the lid of the pack. Underneath, see, there's another compartment on the inside that I find handy to have some of the stuff I don't need while I'm out, like my wallet and my car keys and stuff like that. I like to keep that on in the inside pocket of the lid. There is a is this two flaps on top of the packs that you can close to prevent snow and debris from getting into the pack. Also have this little strap that you can adjust to put on top of the underside of the lid, you can say. I usually use this just to tighten it, compress the pack a little bit, but I guess you can put some gear in there if you have something long. I have used this a couple of times for the tripod for my camera. And I guess you can also use it for something like a sleeping pad if you have a long foam one. On the inside of the bag there is one pocket next to your back that I guess would be suitable for like a water bladder, and there's also one mesh pocket in the front of the inside of the backpack. On the other side of that front you also have this this large mesh, flexible mesh pocket that I like to use for something like my this little foldable foam thing I used to sit on sometimes. I put it in here. Also my rain gear and some other stuff that I need to have access to while I'm walking in the woods. So this mesh compartment on the outside I like quite much. You also have this opening in the front where you can get access to the inside of the pack without having to go in through the top. That can be useful. I know some people dislike that kind of opening, but I haven't had any problems with it, because if you don't use it you don't notice it. It doesn't get open by itself. The pack also have on the sides, it's two of these stretchable mesh pockets. That's really handy. And you have these straps. Usually when I go out I use this to put my camera tripod on the side. I also use it for a fishing rod, so you can have it on the sides of the pack. So yeah, the lid is made in a way so you can just snap it off. That's useful in a few different ways. One thing is that I like to keep a lot of my small stuff inside the lid of my backpacks, so I can just take it off when I get to camp, and I can strap it onto something and have it available somewhere in my camping spot without having to go to the backpack. So I can keep things a little bit more separated and organized at the same time in my camping spot. This lid can also be turned into a hip pack with a belt. That can be handy if you have some kind of a base camp and you want to do some day trips and some hikes around in the area. You can put the most essential stuff inside this little thing without having to carry the whole backpack. There's also this little pocket on top that you can use almost like a small backpack with this lid. So it's kind of a handy little detail there. I think the most important thing with the backpack is that it's comfortable to wear. As I said, it has this flexible system with the frame of the pack that moves, and it also have some good padding on the hip belt and on the shoulder straps, so you can distribute the weight really good even if you put quite a lot of weight inside this pack. I think it's rated to like a maximum of 25 kilos or something like that, and usually that's enough for my even my winter camps. I have actually put a little bit more, something in a little bit over 30 kilos in this pack, and it still was quite comfortable to walk with. So I have I have really gotten to like this pack a lot. The pack is about 2.5 kilos. I don't remember all the numbers for these packs. So it's a little bit heavier than the ultralight hikers like to have, but for me it's light enough, and it's really flexible, and it's a pack that I can use for pretty much all kinds of trips all through the year. So it's it's my main pack, and you will probably see this one in a lot of videos in the future. The next pack is this Bergans Powerframe. It is actually quite simple but super sturdy, and it's one of the largest backpacks I think on the market. It's made of a really sturdy nylon material, a lot thicker than the Trollhetta model I have, and it's of course a lot larger. The 130 liter is just the main room. In addition to the large one big room in the front here, is two side pouches that attach to each side. You can of course take them off, and each of these two pouches are 15 liters, and you can zip them together and make a pretty good day pack, I think. So it's a system. Also, this lid you can take all the way off. This does not convert into some kind of hip pack, but I like to take it off and hang it somewhere where I can get access to the stuff, the small stuff. It's just one, basically one big room inside the lid, and I also have the same kind of pocket on the inside that I like to use to keep the my wallet and car keys and stuff like that. This pack is quite heavy, some might say. It's about 4.5 kilos, and it's got this external frame, so it gives a lot of support. And this pack is basically made to carry really heavy loads. I use it from time to time when I bring a lot of stuff. Sometimes I have been using it when I go out with some friends. And I remember one time I was out with my sister and my cousin and a few other people with kids and everything, and we're going to walk for a little while, and to get to the spot we're going to have a barbecue, and we had a nice time. But the others didn't have much to carry their stuff in. They just came with some plastic bags, and then it was nice to have this large compartment so I can just put everything inside and carry it in a much more convenient way. Because when you have a really good support system like it is on this pack, with shoulder straps and an exceptionally sturdy hip belt, you can carry a lot of weight without it being uncomfortable. I think they rate the recommended weight for this backpack something like 25 kilos and upwards. So if you're going to carry some small and light stuff, this is probably not the pack. But there's also another thing you can do with this pack. You can actually take away this nylon pack and use just the frame. As you can see here, I've now taken off this nylon part of the pack, and I'm only left with this really, really sturdy welded aluminium frame with, of course, the support system. And this can be used for a lot of different things. I have seen people carry big tools into the woods, like chainsaws and barrels of fuel and stuff like that. You can also use it. I've seen people putting a boat engine on this frame to carry it into some small lakes, do some fishing. And the pack is marketed as a hunting backpack, so I guess you can also make some big, large packages with meat and carry out some game with this with just the frame. That would also work really good. And as I said, this can take a lot of weight, so you can probably even carry out an injured person, especially if it's not a very big person, like a kid or something with a broken leg. And just strap them to the backpack. So yeah, I really like this power frame concept. It's probably not a backpack that's for everyone, but I like it. I like to have it in my tool selection, to say it like that. The next pack I want to talk about is this a little bit lighter weight. You can call it a day pack, and I guess you can put some really compact lightweight gear and do some overnighters with this one as well. It's called a Rondane 30 liter, and it's also from Bergans. It's got a quite simple support system. It's a little bit of padding, and you can do a little bit of adjustment on the height, and it's got a flexible hip belt, so you will support the weight on the hips and on the shoulders on this pack, as well as the two larger ones. And the inside is just one large room. And you have this sleeve on the back for a hydration system, but it's no other pockets on the inside. And you have one fairly good sized pocket in the lid. And you have this mesh pocket on the outside that's good for some waterproofs and maybe some snacks that you can get access to during the day when you're out hiking. I actually bought this pack quite a few years ago when I was going on a weekend trip to Italy, actually. And I wanted something I could fit pretty much everything I needed for the trip in the carry-on luggage on the plane. So that's why I ended up with this one. But I also found that it's really handy to bring out for some day hikes. It's a good quality little pack. I also have this a little bit older pack. It's made out of some kind of canvas material, and with some nice leather details all around. It's called a Bergans Original. I think it's from the area right after the Second World War. So it's a pretty old pack, and it's a good size. I don't know the exact size of it, but you have an external frame. I don't know if it's aluminium or if it's steel. It's welded, and it looks to be really, really sturdy. I think you can take it off, but I don't think it doesn't have the same purpose as the frame on the power frame. So I just leave it on. And this one has got the small pocket inside the lid. You can't take the lid off. Inside you have just one large room that can fit quite a lot of stuff. I think it's a little bit larger than my small day pack. You have two side pockets. That's good for more than a 1 liter Nalgene bottle in each of them. And you also have this in front with a fairly large room. So this pack, it's my old school, a little bit more traditional looking pack. I have used it a little bit, and I will probably use it a little bit more, but I think this is more of an historical kind of novelty backpack. I think Bergans started to make backpacks. I believe they released the first model in 1909, so it's one of the very, very oldest backpack manufacturers in the whole world. And what they did that was a little bit special is that they started to using a frame like this. I believe that the first model that they released was made out of leather. And a few years later, they started to make this, use this canvas material instead. It's probably a little bit more sturdy in wet conditions. The last backpack I want to talk about is this Bergans Stordalsbu 35. It is marketed as a hunting backpack. It's got this external frame with a seat on it. I guess that's the main thing with this pack. And it's got a quite simple support system, some a little bit of padding in the back, and a little bit of padding in the shoulder straps, but no hip belt on this one. It's got a good of this pockets in the lid, which I always like on backpacks. And it's got two large side pockets and one outside in the front there. So it's and there's some mesh pocket inside here. And on the inside is basically one large room with a pocket against the back with that you can use for like an hydration bladder. You also have this on the inside of the lid that I like, where you can put car keys and wallets and stuff like that. Stuff you don't need while you're out. All of this is kind of getting into a routine on how to use the different backpacks, so it's kind of similar every time you go out, so you know where your stuff is. I guess everyone will do this in different ways, but I have figured out a way that I could use the different compartments for different standard gear, so I know where I can find my stuff. The reason why I got this pack is because I used to have a really similar one. It was also from Bergans. It was a 50 liter hunting pack. On that pack, the share was on the inside, inside the main compartment of the pack. So it was a little bit more hustle when I was going out moose hunting this fall, and I really was missing to just quietly be able to sit down on the pack and just sit there for without disturbing every wildlife in the area by opening the main compartment and taking out this chair. So I think this is a lot better for that kind of hunting. And compared to my other backpacks, this is made in a little bit different material. It's some kind of silent nylon material that makes a lot less noise when you're out and moving around in the bushes. So, and you also have this sleeve to protect the frame of the pack from rubbing against your rifle or your shotgun when you're out hunting. So I think it's a really good thought out backpack for hunting trips, and also if you do ice fishing or other kinds of fishing, or just generally hang around the campfire if you're out for a little day trip with some friends and you don't have logs to sit on, it's always nice to have a chair. So it's a nice useful pack that I haven't got around to use yet, but it's got a really specific purpose in my tool selection. So I think this one will be getting a lot of use in the time to come. I see that a lot of people like to use this military style backpacks with this modular construction, with this molly pouches, and you can pretty much turn them into whatever you like. I have not all that much experience with that kind of backpacks, but it really doesn't appeal to me at all. I like to have an integrated system when it comes to backpacks, that I can put everything inside and not with too much pockets and stuff on the outside that that moves around. I have had some backpacks with some rather large outside pockets. Some of my packs have that, and sometimes I just tend to, at least on my large backpack, the Powerframe, just take them off and leave them at home because they move around too much. I would much rather have a large compartment that I can put everything inside. I don't like to put sleeping bags on the outside of the pack, and if it's possible, I even like to put my sleeping pad inside, tents, tarps, everything. Get it inside, tightening the compartment together so it's not moving around at all. That's my preferred way to pack the gear into my backpack. I have also, on my last hunting pack, there was this compartment where you can mount the rifle on underneath one of the side pockets, which at the time I bought it sounded like a brilliant idea. But it really wasn't, at least not for me. It was, I couldn't cinch it down tight enough, so it was moving a little bit when I was walking around. And it was a little bit of a hustle to get access to the rifle. So I believe, especially if you go out hunting with shotguns and you hunt for small game, you need to have access to the shotgun at all times. So it's much better to have this, at least for me, this smaller pack and the shotgun on a sling over the shoulder. That gives me much more control and access to the to the gun. That's one of the main things when they're out hunting. And yeah, so it's, I guess it's a lot of different philosophies and approaches, and it probably comes down to experience and what you're used to. But at least the way I see the whole thing with the packs, I am pretty happy with the 5 backpacks I have at the moment. So the next thing I want to talk a little bit about is dry bags, waterproof bags. I have been using this kind of dry bag for quite some time now. And this is a really, really cheap dry bag I bought from China on eBay. I'm pretty sure that there are better dry bags than this around. But I bought a few of these, and they have yeah, they work pretty good, and they are made of a really thin and lightweight material, so it doesn't weigh much. And what I really enjoy using this for is to keep my clothing. I really like to pack up my clothes inside my pack in a way that it stays dry, even though the pack gets a little wet. And a dry bag like this is, yeah, I found a really good solution for just that. I also like to keep this dry bag outside the opening of my hammock. I've been sleeping a lot in hammocks over the last years, and I think it's a good thing to have somewhere to put the clothes during the night. So I have this outside the hammock. I take off my my outer layers and pack them in this, and that means that I have them readily available if I have to go out in the night to do something, or when I wake up in the morning, it's right there next to my hammock, and it's always dry, even in a little bit misty, or even if it's raining, or in the winter time when you get all this this frost and snow drifts and everything, it stays pretty dry inside this dry bag. So yeah, I've been enjoying these cheap dry bags quite a lot. I also tried a couple of other models. I have like this. I use this one as a food bag on this trip. That's also one of the things I use dry bags for, because I don't want to have my my food stored in such a way that it gets everywhere if the packaging breaks. And yeah, but this material on this blue one is a little bit thicker. It's more plasticky, not like the thin nylon that I have on the orange. So this is a little bit more heavy. I guess it's even a little bit more waterproof, but it weighs quite a bit more. And I bought another one, a quite big black one, that's really heavy duty, but that's quite heavy, so I haven't used it much. Another thing you can use dry bags like this for is as a liner for a backpack. If you have a backpack like this that isn't completely waterproof, then you can take a dry bag and put it inside. Of course, you can put it in without stuff inside it. And then you can, after the dry bag is safely inside the pack, the dry bag needs to be a little bit bigger than the pack itself. So if you have a big backpack, you need a really big dry bag, of course, to do this. And then you just stuff everything in and you twist it up and yeah, do it in the proper way. And then suddenly you have a waterproof backpack. So that's one of the best ways to keep everything inside the backpack completely dry. So that's a little something. Another thing I like to use dry bags for is for my sleeping bag. I can show you. I have two sleeping bags, and both came in nylon stuff sacks like this. And this isn't waterproof. So if I lose my backpack on my way into my camping spot, inside the creek or into water, or if it gets really wet from rain, there's a small chance that the sleeping bag will get wet inside this stuff sack. So I went out and bought this waterproof stuff sack from Sea to Summit. It's called Event Waterproof, and I think the Event is the fabric on one of the sides here, because you can compress it and it lets out a little bit of the pressure, the air pressure inside when you compress it. And yeah, it compresses actually quite a lot better than the stuff sack that came with the sleeping bag originally. But these, of course, are synthetic sleeping bags, so they doesn't compress all that much. At least if you compare it to something like a down bag that compresses really down to a small size, then a compression system like this would be really, really useful. But yeah, that's a topic for another video, I guess. The choice of sleeping bags. The next I want to talk about is insulated bags. I did a little bit of research and found out that I really liked the design of this guy. This is a small cooler from a company called Polar Bear. This size is called the six pack, so I guess you can imagine the capacity. But I think this is quite an interesting little cooler that's possible to bring out in the woods if you have some food that you want to keep cool. If you want to keep it even frozen for a couple of days, you could probably do it in this one. It's made out of a Cordura nylon material, so it's a soft one, and it's of course waterproof. You can put ice cubes inside, or you can use some kind of cooling elements. My plan is to just bring out meat that's straight from the freezer, so it's frozen when I take it out. Then I can defrost it out in the forest. So that's not a long-term solution, but just for a couple of days, that could be a really good way to do it, I think. And then you can use this frozen piece of meat to cool down some other kind of groceries that you want to keep fresh and cold. And this, I think, also have some usage in the winter time to keep stuff from freezing. That's I have some plans for to try out some stuff with that. I did buy a little while ago this insulated cover for my Nalgene bottles. It's got this reflective material on the inside and a little bit of foam, I think, inside the pouch itself. And the size is pretty good. And yeah, my thought was to use this in the winter time, but I've tried it a couple of times and it doesn't work all that good. It doesn't prevent the freezing much at all, I think. So just to put the bottle inside a thick wool sock or something like that would probably do the same mission. But yeah, I have it and I'll probably use it sometimes. I guess you can also use this to keep hot water heated for a longer time inside this little insulated thing. And it would also be more possible to touch it if you have boiling water inside an Nalgene bottle. Because I really like these bottles. This video isn't about water containers as such. That's more of like some food related things. But I like to bring water in Nalgene bottles because they're really sturdy. They can stand to freeze completely. And you can also, as I said, pull boiling water inside without deforming it, at least not much. And yeah, it's some good water bottles. I also have a larger, they call it Nalgene canteen, a 3-liter water bottle that I use sometimes. And a while ago I also bought this Camelback, this hydration system that I've been using a few times. I like the idea when I'm hiking to stay hydrated, but I regret that I bought this this tiny little pack for it. It would be really nice if I had bought one of the models they make with a little bit more of space, so I could put some food and some other stuff inside this little pack. But yeah, for what it is, I think it's a good little system. I also do have a few different smaller pouches, like this one, this small pocket organizer pouch from my expedition. I have been using this on every single trip since I bought it. It's pre-packed at home. I have some backup stuff in here. I have stuff that I don't use on every trip, but it's always nice to have it with me. It's some extra fire starters, another flashlight, a backup knife, and this is, I think, one of the smallest of these organizer pouches, and it fits my need pretty good, because I usually don't bring all that much of this small gadgets when I'm out, but some of this stuff I've been using quite frequently. I have two more pouches from Maxpedition. I have this one I use a lot. It's called cocoon or something like that, and I use it for my cordage, and it's been a really, really good way, I think, to store the cordage I need to pitch my tarps, and to have these prosic loops. Everything is in this little pouch. I also got 6 of these small tent pegs. I got them from DD Hammocks. They are the super light tent pegs from DD Hammocks. I can fit 6 of them inside this little pouch, and it's really, really handy to have this this with me. I always put this inside my pack when I go out, because you never know what you run into. And a little while ago I bought this one. It is this dump pouch, I think they call it, rolly poly, that you attach to your belt with a belt loop on the back, and you have it so you can it's like an extra super large pocket, basically, that you can use when you go out to collect some tinder. You can use it to collect a little bit of wild edibles, I think. When it comes to collecting mushrooms and berries, it's probably not the best, but for collecting other kinds of materials, this can be a nice little pouch to have. And it's a little bit in the style of these more medieval and ancient leather pouches, because back in the days people didn't have pockets in their clothing. That's actually a quite new invention. So back in the days people always had to have some kind of pouch hanging from the belt to carry the small stuff, like this little leather belt pouch. I have some fire starting stuff and some Viking age stuff inside this. I have some plans for some future videos with this stuff. But that's the Maxpedition stuff. Of course, you don't have to buy expensive pouches. You can claim that it's a waste of money, and they're probably completely right. But I wanted to try it out and see what the brand was about, and the quality seems to be top notch. I also have another pouch from Fjällräven. I actually forgot to bring it out on this trip, but it's called a pocket, and it's this it's just a pocket, a square G1000 fabric square that I can wear around my neck as an extra pocket. That's exactly what it is. I actually bought it to use in the winter time to keep my batteries on the inside of my clothing. I thought that could be a really nice idea to keep them warm, to make them last a little bit longer. So yeah, the Fjällräven pocket, I've used it a few times. The quality seems to be extremely good, but it's probably way overpriced, I think. I paid too much for it, but I wanted to try it out. So I don't know if I recommend it because of the price, but because if you see just the quality, it's a really good piece of kit. And of course, you can do it the cheap way, just some cotton fabric and some string. You can make a lot of small pouches yourself, or you can buy. And this is from also from eBay. I didn't pay probably more than it would cost me to make it myself. And this is a small fire kit. Yeah, so you can see it's a lot of different kinds of pouches that can be useful. And I guess I've showed you the small stuff that I use. Just one more thing I want to show you. This is just a regular plastic bag, like you get in the grocery store. And I always like to bring one or two of these as well when I'm go out to collect the garbage and to keep it contained. And these are of course disposable, so you just throw it in the bin when you get home. It makes taking out and cleaning out your backpack easier. And it's also useful if you have some small pieces of kit that you want to be able to find inside the pack. If you don't have a pouch for it, you can just put some stuff inside this and leave it in one of the pockets in the pack. That also is something I do from time to time. Next, I want to talk a little bit about pouches and bags for camera and audio equipment. As you probably would have guessed, I bring a camera out on my trips to film for YouTube. And there's a lot of people that like to go out and do photography, or you can also go out and capture audio, like doing field recordings. That's at least for me just as exciting and fascinating and captivating as capturing the images. But to carry all this stuff, you also need some bags to protect the gear and to make it available when you need it. The bag I've been using the most is this one. It fits my mirrorless camera, and I have two lenses usually with me, which two I change out a little bit from trip to trip, depending on what I'm going to do. But usually I bring two lenses and my Sony A7 camera, and this all fits inside this main compartment. I also have some spare adapters and some other things in this little bag. And in this large front pocket, I can fit the microphone, the camera mount microphone that I have on top of my camera. So this little pouch is made from some canvas, some cotton canvas, I think. And it's padded, so it protects the camera a little bit. It's not really, really padded. But it's made, I don't know if it's the company that makes it. It's the brand is National Geographics, and they make some really, really good-looking camera bags. I think I have three. This is the medium size that I usually always bring. I have one that's a little bit larger, not much, that I will bring if I need to bring a couple more lenses. And I also have this smaller one that's a little bit different color. that's yeah, I can't fit my large camera in this one, but I've been using it for some of the spare batteries and also some audio equipment. I'm planning on doing more on the audio side in the future, so I will probably bring some more audio equipment out on my trips, and for that I will probably use this, or maybe I have to get some new bags as well, but we'll see about that. At the moment I'm using the National Geographic camera bags the most. I also have this little LowPro pouch I use for my point and shoot camera. As you see, I have it in my leg pocket, because when I'm out in the woods, you never know when you run into something special. You can run into some wildlife, or you can suddenly you come up in a situation where you need to capture something right away, and then I like to keep the small camera in my pocket. But the pouch I have it with me into the forest in is this little LowPro. I also have another LowPro bag that I can fit my large camera with just one lens. I've had quite a few LowPro branded camera bags over the years, and they are really, really good brand, I think. At home I have this LowPro backpack where I keep a few of my all of my lenses and some more of my camera gear just for storage. I think it's a little bit too much to bring out on trips like this, because it's a fairly large backpack, but it's quite good to carry when you're going to do some more photography or specific videography trips. I also have one bag from a brand called Think Tank, and this is really good quality as well, Think Tank. I don't have the need for this specific bag on a lot of my trips at the moment, because I don't have any lenses. I have sold off quite a few lenses over the years. But this you can expand at the bottom, so you can fit the camera with a fairly long lens inside. But I don't, as I said, I don't need that at the moment, but I have some plans to get some longer lenses to be able to do some more wildlife video. I want to capture a little bit of the animals that live out in these woods, and then you need to get the subject a little bit closer, then you need a longer lens. So this Think Tank bag will for certain be with me on some future trips. I also have a couple more products from Think Tank that I also use. I have this is for spare batteries. You can say it's a waste of weight, but I think it's really, really convenient to have a system where you have the spare batteries and you can organize which one is empty and which one is full. It's also easy when you get back home to have a pouch for the spare batteries, because my Sony camera, it uses a lot of batteries, and these are tiny little cells that doesn't last for too long. So I have to bring quite a few batteries when I'm out, and then this is good. I also have this from Think Tank for AA's. You can actually fit 8 of them inside. I have, at the moment, I have 4 AA's and 4 AAA's. And again, it's convenient. You know where the batteries are. I think it's really important to organize the camera gear, and the more stuff you bring, the more important it is to have a system that you actually works for you. So that's that one. I also have this also from Think Tank to have spare memory cards in. Usually I don't bring this one because I have one large memory card inside my my main camera. I have one card inside my point and shoot camera, and also one inside my little field recorder. That's and all of these will last me with plenty of space for one trip, so I don't have to swap out memory cards all that often. And yeah, in the future I'll probably buy a backup memory card for each of the cameras, and then they will stay inside this little pouch. So all in all, my recommendations if you want to look into some high quality camera bags: take a look at the National Geographic brand if you want something that looks a little bit retro. This one has some leather and some brass buckles and made of canvas. Really good. The Low Pro stuff is a good budget brand, I think. Not too expensive, but still really professional and really good quality. And the Think Tank stuff is a little bit more high end, and they also have some really interesting products. So yeah, that's my my recommendations. As I mentioned about this haversack thing, shoulder bags, this bag is a shoulder bag. I can wear it on my hip like this, and for a camera bag I think this is quite useful, because then if I walk around I can have stuff available all the time, and I don't run and walk for long distances with this. But when I'm out swapping lenses, doing some b-roll, yeah, and I need to have stuff available, then this is good. I also have another shoulder bag that I've had since I was really just a kid, and it's this one. It's my fishing bag. It's from Abu Garcia, Swedish brand. I don't think it's a exceptionally good fishing bag, but I have used it for many, many years, and I just haven't gotten around to change it out. It's when I go fishing, it's the same thing. Usually I put this inside my backpack when I go out, and when I take out my fishing gear to go around the lake or do the fishing itself, then I put on this, and then I have everything available. The boxes with lures, fishing line. This one is made in such a way that I can put my my catch inside, and it's this detachable thing inside that's waterproof, so I doesn't mess up all my other stuff that's in the big compartment. So it's fairly good. I think it's a little bit too large for what I usually need. And as I said, it's a shoulder bag, so it bumps into all kinds of stuff when you're walking through bushes and between trees and stuff like that. It gets often snagged, but yeah, at least with a bag like this, I have the fishing gear available when I need it while I'm out fishing. Next, I want to talk about something that's I guess related to this topic. It's about tools, and cutting tools in particular, like knives and axes and saws. I think you always need to keep them in some kind of safe sheath. You can see, if you bring some kind of knife or an axe, you really, really want to keep this inside of a safe sheet, because if you have something like this just lying around inside your backpack, it would definitely break something, and it will cut some stuff into pieces. The same goes for like belt knives. You always want to keep it in the sheath. Don't have it lying around, because you will definitely step on it, or you will hurt yourself in some kind of way if you don't treat these sharp objects with a lot of respect. The same goes for axes and saws. Always keep them inside a safe sheath. Sometimes when you buy camping gear, it comes with its own bag or stuff sack, like this sleeping bag. Also, a lot of cooking gear comes with its own bags and pouches, and I think that's really, really useful. And in most cases, the stuff that comes with the gear is good enough. You don't need to upgrade in any way, like I choose to do with my sleeping bag cover. But yeah, there's probably a whole lot more I could say about different aspects about bags and backpacks and pouches. But yeah, I think I've given you my thoughts on this topic in quite detail, I think. There's one little thing I want to mention before I end this section, and that's rain covers, because a lot of backpacks, they comes with these rain covers that you have inside a pouch and you pull over the outside of the backpack. My backpacks do not have that, and in fact I don't miss it, and I've heard a lot of people that have had problems with that kind of rain cover, because if you're out in really stormy and rainy conditions, these covers you just pull over the backpack tends to get floppy in the wind, and you always get water in from the back between the backpack and your back and your backpack. So what I prefer to do is to use something like a rain poncho that goes over both me and the backpack. I think that's a better solution. I have dedicated rain poncho, and I also have this fjellduk, this jervenduk, this mountain blanket that I bring it on a few trips. And this also goes above my head and covers my upper body and to the knees, and also my backpack. So I think this is probably the best way to go when if you want to keep your backpack away from the rain. That's if you want to keep the outside of the pack dry. If you just want to keep, don't care about the backpack itself, you just want to keep the inside dry, you can always use a liner, as I showed you with the dry sack, a dry bag. That's another option. So that was my thoughts and my gear when it comes to bags and backpacks and all that kind of stuff. And I really hope that at least a few of you find some of my thoughts and ideas interesting on this subject.